Hello everybody, today I'm going to be talking about pathology of the breast diseases, and I'll be dealing with it under the following headings: normal histology, common breast lesions, CA breast and gynecomastia. Firstly, coming to the normal histology of the breast, and this is to know the basics, and as I've already explained this in my previous video about anatomy of the breast. Firstly, the lining epithelium of the alveoli, when it is active, that is when the mother is in a pregnancy or in during lactation, it is lined by columnar epithelium, and inactive, it is lined by the cuboidal epithelium. And ducts, the smaller ducts are lined by a single layer of columnar epithelium. The larger ducts are lined by more than two layers of the same columnar epithelium, and the terminal ducts are lined by stratified squamous keratinized epithelium. And this is the basic anatomy. This is the lactiferous sinus. This drains lactiferous sinus. Lactiferous ducts drains into the lactiferous sinus. This forms the interlobular, and there are it can be divided into multiple lobule, and these lobule consists of alveoli. Alveoli lined by the columnar epithelium. So alveoli, intralobular ducts, interlobular ducts, lactiferous ducts, lactiferous sinus for storage of the milk. Now the alveoli, the columnar epithelium of alveoli, the secretions has two parts. One is the lipid component and the protein component. The lipid component is given off from the apical portion of the gland, and it forms the apocrine gland. Why apocrine gland? Because the tip of the gland is pinched off. While the lipid component is secreted, whereas the protein component is secreted from the basal part of the columnar gland, and it is the merocrine gland. Why merocrine? Because the protein component is secreted through exocytosis, and the gland remains intact. And the both the alveoli and the ducts are lined by myoepitheliocytes, and it is these myoepitheliocytes contraction which helps in the drainage of milk from the alveoli up to the lactiferous sinus. And stroma is lined by fat and connective tissue. And as we see over here, this is the inactive breast, which has very few alveoli, and large part of it is made up of the stroma. And active gland, wherein the stromal component is reduced and is alveoli is hypertrophied. There will be many number of alveoli with secretion of secreted milk. Anatomic origin of the common breast lesions, and this is a very important diagram from the Robbins. So we see from the TDLU, that is terminal duct and lobular units, arises cysts, sclerosing adenosis, squamous papilloma, epithelial hyperplasia, atypical hyperplasia and carcinoma. From the larger ducts arises ductal ectasia, squamous metaplasia of lactiferous ducts, large duct papilloma and Paget's disease. From the intralobular stroma, not interlobular, intralobular stroma arises fibroadenomas and Phyllod's tumor. From interlobular stroma arises fat necrosis secondary to trauma, lipoma, fibromatosis and sarcoma. And from the nipple and areola is the Paget's disease of nipple. The various breast lesions, it can be classified into inflammatory lesions and benign epithelial lesions. Inflammatory lesions, first one is acute mastitis. Acute mastitis is nothing but infection of the glands, and this usually occurs in lactating women. As the baby sucks the nipple, there will be multiple cracks formed, and this allows the bacteria to invade, and most commonly it is the Staph aureus bacteria. And usually patients presents with erythematous and painful lesion along with fever. Next is the squamous metaplasia of lactiferous duct or Suska disease. This usually occurs secondary to smoking or vitamin A deficiency among women. They present with recurrent subareolar abscess. And these abscesses, for the drainage of this abscess, cannot occur through the normal path, because there will be squamous metaplasia of the nipple ducts. So there will be keratin plug formed, which leads to the blockage of the duct. And so for the drainage of this abscess, a fistula will be formed. This is Zuska disease. And there is duct ectasia. Duct ectasia, this usually presents as palpable periareolar mass, and ectasia is nothing but there will be dilation of the lobules and ducts. So these dilated lobules and ducts stores the secreted milk and presents as the palpable mass. And next is fat necrosis. This occurs secondary to trauma. Now coming to benign epithelial lesions. Benign epithelial lesions, it can be classified into non-proliferative lesions and proliferative lesions. Under non-proliferative lesions are the cysts, fibrosis and adenosis. Cysts, there will be multiple dilation of lobules, and many such dilated lobules coalesce and form one large cyst. And fibrosis, when the secretion from the cysts discharge, there will be chronic inflammatory reaction towards these secretions, followed by fibrosis. And adenosis. Adenosis is nothing but there will be increased in the number of SNI per lobule. And this usually occurs in pregnant women, but also can present in non-pregnant women. This is nothing but increase in the number of SNI per lobule. Now coming to proliferative lesions. This can be without ATPia and ATPia. Without ATPia and ATPia. Without ATPia is epithelial hyperplasia. Normally, as I've already told, the epithelium, ductal epithelium, is lined by columnar epithelium, two or more layers, and myoepitheliocytes. And when there is increased proliferation of both myoepitheliocytes and the columnar epithelium, it forms epithelial hyperplasia. Next is sclerosing adenosis. In this, there will be both proliferation of the alveolar glands as well as the stroma. As we see over here, there is increased stromal proliferation and alveoli, and this stroma goes and compresses the alveoli. Next, coming to duct papilloma. Duct papilloma is nothing but there will be multiple fibrovascular cores arising from the duct. Now, with ATPia is atypical ductal hyperplasia and atypical lobular hyperplasia. This usually refers resembles DCIS, and this resembles LCIS. And what is the significance of these epithelial lesions is the risk of malignancy. It is 3% in non-proliferative lesions, 5 to 7% in lesions without ATPia, and 13 to 17% in lesions with ATPia. Now coming to the important topic, carcinoma of breast, and how this the carcinoma evolutes is from a normal breast to a precursor lesion to CA in situ. And there will be erosion of the basement membrane and invasive carcinoma. And we see that greater than 95% of breast malignancy are adenocarcinoma, which usually arise from terminal duct and lobular unit, as I have already shown in the figure. First, we will see CA in situ. CA in situ can be of two types. One is ductal carcinoma in situ and lobular carcinoma in situ. In ductal carcinoma in situ, there will be malignant clonal proliferation of epithelial cells, usually from the ducts and lobules, and it is limited by the basement membrane, that is, the cells do not erode the basement membrane. Ductal DCIS can be of two major types. One is comedo and other one is non-comedo. Comedo is usually more aggressive as compared to non-comedo. Comedo carcinoma, this is, it's usually detected in mammography, and it usually presents as a cluster of linear or branching areas of calcification, as we see in this picture. And histologically, there are two characteristic features. One is there will be tumor cells with pleomorphic high grade nuclei, and second is areas of central necrosis. As we see, there is central necrosis and high grade pleomorphic cells over here, and central necrosis. And those tumors which lack these two characteristic features are considered under non-comedo carcinoma. It can be of creepyform variety, as we see, sieve-like pattern is present. This resembles creepyform plate, and micropapillary variant, which can arise with or without fibrovascular cores, multiple papillae with or without underlying fibrovascular core. Now coming to lobular carcinoma in situ. Over here there is clonal proliferation of same ducts and lobules, but what is the difference is in discohesive manner. Discohesive means there is no cell to cell adhesion. So they grow in discohesive manner. Why? Because there is loss of function mutation in CDH1 gene. This CDH1 gene encodes a protein called E-catherin, which is responsible for cell to cell adhesion. And as there is not much desmoplastic reaction, it cannot be detected by mammography, and it's an incidental finding of breast biopsy. And so we see that even after the introduction of mammography as the screening procedure, the incidence of LCIS has not come down. Incidence of lobular carcinoma has not come down. And in histology, we see mucin positive signet ring cells, which are round cells, and these are cells are not attached to each other. And on immunohistochemistry, we see cells that are E-catherin negative. Immunohistochemistry with E-catherin, we see cells that are negative for E-catherin. The difference between lobular and ductal. Ductal can be detected on mammography, lobular cannot. Bilaterality, there is 20-40% incidence of bilateral tumors in lobular as compared to just 10-20% in ductal. And multifocal, that is tumors arising in different quadrants, occurs in lobular, but it is not seen in ductal carcinoma. And the risk of malignancy in the same breast is 1% per year, but we see that in lobular carcinoma even there is increase in malignancy in contralateral breast as well. There is high incidence, but this is not seen in ductal carcinoma. Now coming to the different types of invasive carcinoma. Invasive carcinoma can be classified as ductal and special. Ductal is generally carcinomas under ductal carcinoma are the ones which does not have any special histological subtype. And under special, those which have special histological subtype are invasive lobular carcinoma, medullary, mucinous, papillary, tubular, and certain rare varieties like adenoid cystic, squamous cell carcinoma, and apocrine carcinoma. And we see that the tubular carcinoma has the best prognosis. Tubular carcinoma has the best prognosis. Now first is the ductal carcinoma. Ductal carcinoma, it is the most common subtype of carcinoma. It usually presents as hard, irregular radiodense mass. Why radiodense? Because there is high desmoplastic stromal reaction. Nothing but there is increased proliferation of fibrous tissue in the stroma. So this is detected as radiodense tissue. On cut section, we see there will be a small central foci, and from this there will be streaks of calcification arising. As we see in this, streaks of calcification from a central nidus. And we see on histology, we see increased desmoplastic reaction, that is increased stroma and atypical ductal proliferation of the ductal cells. And grading, we use Nottingham histological score, and this is based on tubule formation, nuclear pleomorphism, and the mitotic rate. Mitotic activity, very important. Tubule formation, nuclear pleomorphism, and mitotic activity. Now coming to lobular carcinoma, and as I've already told, in LCIS there is CDH1 gene mutation, loss of function mutation. This leads to cell growing in discohesive manner, that is there is no cell to cell adhesion. So the individual single cells come and infiltrate the stroma, that is the basement membrane, and we see there will be a single file of cells as shown in this figure. This is called as Indian file pattern. And as these individual cells, they fail to evoke the desmoplastic response. So usually under mammography we cannot find a radiodense mass under mammography. And there is characteristic pattern of metastasis present in this, and these are, it usually goes into the peritoneum, ovary, GIT, uterus, and leptomeninges. And there is increased risk of gastric signet ring cell CA as well. And this is the histological finding. We see many signaling cells, that is cells with clear cytoplasm and nuclei is put towards periphery, clear cytoplasm and nuclei towards the periphery. Now coming to the medullary carcinoma. Medullary carcinoma, many of these are associated with BRCA1 gene mutation, and as we will study in the molecular subtypes, they are estrogen receptor negative, progesterone receptor negative tumors belonging to the basal variety. They usually present as soft, well circumscribed mass, and under histology we see large syncytium of poorly differentiated cells, frequent mitotic figures, and very important, there will be lymphoplasmocytic infiltrates. We see over here lymphoplasmocytic infiltrates. Now coming to the Paget's disease of Nipple, and this is a very rare manifestation of breast carcinoma, around 1 to 4% of the cases, and we see that patients present with scaly crusty lesions over breast that are intensely pruritic, and there will be erythematous eruptions over the nipple. They are usually associated with underlying extensive DCIS or any other invasive carcinoma, and we see that these malignant cells or Paget cells, as we see in this figure, these malignant cells or Paget cells, without eroding the basement membrane, they travel towards the nipple without eroding the basement membrane, and these Paget cells are large pale maculated cells. As we see, this is the cut section of nipple, squamous epithelium, and few Paget cells, large pale maculated cells, and they are usually estrogen receptor negative and usually overexpress HER2/neu. Now lastly coming to the stromal tumors. Stromal tumors, it can arise from intralobular stroma or interlobular stroma. As I've already mentioned, under intralobular stroma there is fibroadenoma and Phyllod's tumor. Under interlobular stroma there are the common connective tissue tumors like lipomas and angiosarcomas, or tumors that are specific to the breast like pseudoangiomatous stromal hyperplasia, myofibroblastosis, and fibrous tumors. Now coming to fibroadenoma, this is the most common benign tumor of female breast, most common benign tumor, and it usually presents in 20 to 30 year old females as multiple or bilateral breast masses, palpable breast mass. As we see clinical presentation, young women in their 20 to 30s, multiple palpable masses, and under mammography they are dense clustered calcification, as we see radiodense lesion under mammography. We see that the epithelial component is hormonally responsive, so during pregnancy we can see there is increase in the size of fibroadenomas. As there is increase in the estrogen there and they are hormonally responsive, there is increase in size, and grossly they may range from 1 centimeter to very large tumors. It can be well circumscribed, rubbery, grayish white nodules. With slit-like spaces, and microscopically we see there is increased proliferation of the stromal component, and these stromal component go and compress the normal ducts. So this gives rise to two patterns. One is pericanalicular pattern, or another is intracanalicular pattern. In intracanalicular pattern we see that their epithelial component is completely compressed. This is the intracanalicular pattern and this is pericanalicular pattern, and the risk of malignancy in fibroadenoma, increased risk we see in cysts greater than 0.3 centimeter or when it is associated with sclerosing adenosis, epithelial calcification, or papillary apocrine change. Now coming to Phyllod's tumor. This Phyllod's tumor presents in 6th decade as compared to fibroadenoma, which presents in a very younger age like 20 to 30 years. This presents usually in 6th decade, usually presents as palpable masses. They are also called as cystosarcoma Phyllod's. we see that there are mutations, most commonly is gain of function mutation in chromosome number 1q, or high grade and more aggressive tumors have mutation in home box 13 gene. Grossly, this phyllodes tumor usually presents as massive large lesions with bulbous protrusions. Why bulbous? Is because there will be underlying nodules of proliferating stroma, and microscopically we see leaf-like lesions, leaf-like pattern. And how we differentiate phyllodes from fibroadenoma is based on their higher cellularity, higher mitotic rate, nuclear pleomorphism, stromal overgrowth and infiltrative borders. And histologically we can grade them into low, intermediate and high grade tumors. Now coming to the last topic, gynecomastia. Gynecomastia is nothing but enlargement of male breast. Pathogenesis, we see that there is imbalance between estrogen and androgens. There is increase in the amount of estrogen and decrease in the amount of androgens. So any state which leads to increase in estrogens will lead to gynecomastia, as we see in cirrhosis, where there is cirrhosis of liver, where the estrogens are not metabolized by the liver due to cirrhosis, or under old age where testicles, there is decreased production of the androgens by the testicles by certain drugs like alcohol, marijuana, heroin, steroids, or can be seen in Klinefelter syndrome. And what it presents as button-like enlargement in the subperiolar region, button-like enlargement. And microscopically we see that there is increased dense collagenous tissue and epithelial hyperplasia of only the ducts and not lobule. We see that there is almost no lobule formation and just the hyperplasia of ducts, just the ducts and not lobules. As we see in this figure, hyperplasia of the ducts and increased stromal component, dense connective tissue. So that's it. Thank you guys. For more such videos, please watch our YouTube channel, The White Army, and subscribe. Thank you.